Hello, everyone, and welcome to RevMD Sex Bites podcast with me, your host, Dr. Debra Durst, and my co-host, Faraday.
Hey, guys. Faraday Golombieski, nurse practitioner here at RevitalyzeMD. And today we have a special guest with us, and I'll let him introduce himself.
Hello there. I'm George Ibrahim at Biltmore Restorative Medicine in Asheville, North Carolina.
Dr. Ibrahim is with Asheville Restorative, right? So that you know. And again, we've been friends for a long time now, and he does a very similar business, and we both do sexual wellness. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We have a great podcast, but I want to, again, kind of prompt you to like and subscribe early. If you like content that's going to improve your sex life, then you will get alerts as to other podcasts. Today, I think the first thing we'll talk about then is maybe the Cialis, Viagra, the little blue pill. What do you think, George?
One of the first things I always tell guys is when we were in our 20s, I'm old, but when we were in our 20s and we could perform pretty regularly whenever we wanted to, Viagra hadn't been invented yet. We had the foundation. It was testosterone. So, the vast majority of guys who come in and that's what they're looking for, Cialis or Viagra, I go, well, your deficiency is probably not Viagra or Cialis. It's more than likely testosterone. But then once a guy's been optimized from his testosterone level, there are going to be some men that are going to need some extra help. And I think that's when Cialis and Viagra come into play, but only after they've optimized their testosterone levels.
Yes. What do you think about? So hormones first.
Hormones.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And just to give you a little background too, Dr. Ibrahim is like a urologist by trade. Yep. Duke trained, and so his background in this is extensive. So, and he's been doing hormone replacement for a long time, so an expert in the field. So when we're talking about them coming in their 30s, 40s, 50s and beyond, HRT or hormone replacement and optimization first.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And then once that's optimized, they still need a little bit more. Then going to Cialis or Viagra, I think, is a very safe and reliable option for some men. There's a trade-off. I do believe Viagra is a little bit stronger, but then it does have bigger side effects. Cialis, not as many side effects, but I don't think it has as big of an oomph or an effect. I tell guys, I look at it as Coke and Pepsi, and then let's pick the one that they prefer. I don't think one's any better than the other. It's just, it's up to the guy. I think the biggest issue is when primary care has just written them a prescription and didn't bother educating the patient on how to take it properly. That's the biggest.
You find those as the biggest problems with patients doing it right?
They do it wrong. most guys that can go out, let's just say date night. They come home, they've eaten this big old steak, baked potato, dessert, belly's full, she might be in the back room changing into something sexy. He then goes in the bathroom, pops a little blue pill. They hop into the bed. It's not going to work.
No.
You cannot take it on a full stomach. Cialis is not as bad, but Viagra and a full stomach, it's not going to be absorbed for 4 to 5 hours. And that's the big, that's where these guys get destroyed on it.
Mm-hmm.
I tell my guys, take it before you go out to eat. It's going to be around in 3 or 4 hours.
Mm-hmm.
But if you come home and you take it on a full stomach, forget about it.
Mm-hmm.
You're ready the next morning, but you're not going to have anything in your body that's going to be working that evening. Empty stomach, empty stomach, empty stomach is really the only way to take either of these two medications.
What's your opinion on daily Cialis? What about those guys?
First of all, it takes an entire month to work up to the therapeutic effect of 120 milligram Cialis. So the guys that are doing the daily 5 milligrams, you just tell them, don't even think that this is going to do anything for you for at least a month. So that's huge because, there are guys that will do the daily, and by daily, they mean 2 or 3 times a week. You can't do that. You've got to take the daily every single day, and it takes a month before it starts to work. So I don't think that's a problem. My bias is the older guys pretty much have an idea of when they're going to be active. So why bother with taking something every day when you know that it might be certain days of the week that you're going to be active? The younger guys where there's more spontaneity, more surprises, I like to say, I think they're better off doing the daily because, they're less.
They don't have to time it.
Routine. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then you don't think that Cialis has as much a problem, but it still has to be on an empty stomach,
yeah,
but not as big an issue.
Exactly. But at the end of the day, you're going to confuse patients. I just tell them, just do it on an empty stomach.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the other biggie that we, you know, have a little ditty in the office that we tell guys, it's face is red, time for bed. Mm. Until they have that facial flush.
It's a good little saying.
That is a good saying. I like that, George.
Yeah. Face is red, time for bed. If it's not, if you don't see it in your face, it's not working down there.
Mm-hmm.
And then you got the guys that know they're going to get nasal congestion. I mean, I've seen this happen more often than you can shake a stick at. You got to tell them, look, you don't take Sudafed, guys. I know you're going to get a little, you know, sinus runniness, you know, your nose is going to run, you might get congested, but Sudafed destroys erections.
Counterproductive.
I've had guys come in, they tell me, I religiously take my Sudafed every time I take my Viagra because I don't want to get that stuffy nose. I go, well, guess what else? You're not going to get an erection either.
That's a guarantee.
Yeah, not going to happen.
So the, again, I've heard it so many times, and I'm sure you have too, where they're going out to dinner and they're afraid that they're going to get an erection, you know, if they take it too early. And you hear that over and over again. So I think they're just not being instructed well by the docs that are actually writing the prescriptions most of the time.
Yeah. And, you know, Viagra and Cialis don't cause erections. They help sustain and promote an erection that has to be caused by something else.
Mm-hmm.
You can take as much Viagra as you want to. You're not going to spontaneously become erect.
Mm-hmm.
Something has to happen to get it to start flowing. But it's just, you're not just going to pop an erection sitting at the table unless something's, you know, arousing you.
What's your opinion on nitric oxide as a supplement to help increase blood flow?
I think it's fantastic. I mean, that's, you know, where Viagra is getting, basically it's starting to work, and having more nitric oxide on board is a great thing to do.
With the Viagra and the Cialis, or do you ever have patients you recommend doing it as an independent supplement?
If they can get away with it as an independent supplement, that's one less thing.
All guys think they can get away with that.
That's it. They all think.
That and they'll arginine. Early on, anyhow. Early.
Yeah.
First steps.
I definitely think it helps Viagra and Cialis work. You know, they're not really that bad off at all if that's all they need is a little bit of nitric oxide, you know.
Correct. Well, and so we ended up recently looking, and I don't know if you and I spoke since, at Berkeley Life. It's a nitric oxide supplement.
Yeah.
And where it has all the nitrates necessary for the conversion and the enzyme to work, which was great too. And they have little strips. So I don't know if we'd ever, the little strips you can test to see where your nitrate level is. And then you actually take a couple of the capsules and you can retest. And it's like having beets and spinach and all that in like a little capsule form.
Yeah.
Way more effective than L-arginine, which has to convert.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
So when they take L-arginine, I'm sorry, what is it?
Those tabs are effective.
Yeah. Well, and we recently did have a compounding pharmacist, and I don't know, again, if we spoke about the combination, but Tim was the one that brought us the Berkeley Life product, just saying, again, he sees a lot more of the PDE5 inhibitor, Cialis, Viagra, work with it. But he does a combination troche. I know you use the same compounding pharmacy we do, but...
Yeah. I've used them.
Okay.
I mean, what you're doing is you're trading down a little of the dosage on the Viagra, you're supplementing it with some of the Cialis. Do you have to, could you get just as good of a result using one versus the other? Probably.
Where I'm seeing it beneficial is my guys that have side effects on high dose Viagra. They seem to do a little bit better being able to have a little bit of a lower dose, still getting that Cialis, that different pathway, and they're able to manage and get erections and keep them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I've seen it most effective.
One of the reasons why the lozenges work really well is the whole idea that you're trying to get as much buccal or absorption through the mouth rather than through the stomach. Because once again, the guy's going to have eaten a big dinner half the time and doing a troche or a lozenge, if they absorb it through their mouth, then they bypass that full stomach. And so I prefer lozenges over the tablets only because I don't care how often you tell these guys, until they finally realize their stomach makes a difference, they really don't realize that the full stomach makes a difference.
I just think they don't hear you. That's all. Like, you know, there's some selectivity.
What is it? They hear about 10% of what we say to them in the office.
Exactly. They may hear more from you, but sometimes there's a selectivity. with an XY occasionally. So maybe that's it. But I think the big thing is, like, is urologists are really, if anything, going more towards the pill and the little blue pill or Viagra Cialis as a treatment for what they need, instead of more comprehensively doing it.
And looking at the hormones and everything else.
And everything else. So if we wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, what other things they can do, because they're coming to us because they're not getting a response to, or they're getting side effects with. And so how we address it otherwise to at least touch on those points.
The pill worked and now it doesn't. Correct. We hear that often.
Mm-hmm. The biggest thing, you know, you're doing hormones. I'm doing hormones. I'm a urologist. The number of times, though, that I write for Viagra and Cialis in a given month is so few. You know, testosterone is doing such a big job. I mean, testosterone is a vasodilator. It helps with libido. Mm-hmm. Viagra and Cialis don't do any of that. Then we have the other new peptides. PT-141, I think, is going to be a blockbuster in the future. And, it's, you know, I think it's going to take the place of Viagra down the road. I mean, you know, it's got a little bit different side effects that we have to teach patients about, but I think PT-141 is a blockbuster.
And PT-141 being a different pathway too. So not even needing a stimulus like you do with the with Cialis and Viagra, the PDE5 inhibitors. Yeah. You don't need a stimulus. That can be spontaneous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So timing.
Timing is big with that one.
Is key, huh?
Figuring out the timing.
But you found that a lot of patients love PT-141.
They do. I mean, you know, we have a pretty nice protocol that maps out how to begin adjusting the dose and monitoring the time to effect, because it is so variable, and the podcast is not the place to get into it.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing about PT-141 is that is not take two and call me in the morning. Everybody's different.
And it's different for them, both side effect profile and timing. So that's huge.
But once they figure it out, you know, it's pretty real repeatable. Mm-hmm. But they got to figure out what their time frame is going to be and what dose is going to be.
Correct. And those are, again, you know, adjuncts to really kind of our core treatment for, you know, sexual wellness, sexual health in men. Because really, when we're talking about performance, number one, as they age, it's hormone decline. So hormones first. And men are easier than women with that, as you well know.
Yes.
So it's one hormone versus
and managing
all of them.
A second.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and I don't mean to interrupt you. No. While men are easier, men are more stubborn. Women go through menopause and it hits them like a ton of bricks. Mm-hmm. But men lose testosterone. Every man's losing it beginning around the age of 25 at about rate of 2-4%. They're losing it little by little, so that by the time a man is 50, 100% of men have lost 50% of what their peak levels were. I'm sorry. You can drive a Maserati with the tires halfway inflated. It's not going to perform, though. No guy in the world would think that a Maserati is going to perform with the tires half inflated. But then here he is thinking he doesn't need help or need more testosterone when his testosterone levels are half of what they should be.
I love the way he talks. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you know, and then by the time they're 60, it's down to a third. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you can get these guys to realize, I don't care how virile they think they are, they're still a third of what they were when they were in their 20s if they're 60 years old. Mm-hmm. Period. Every man.
You're right. Very stubborn, because we have guys in front of us coming in for evaluation. And they're like, well, I don't have a problem. I don't really know why I'm here. It's like, all right.
The wife or partner brings them in and they're sitting in front of us with like all the good marks.
Yeah. Yep.
All of them.
And they're like, I'm totally fine. I'm like, all right, we'll just get blood. Yeah. We'll go from there.
You go through the symptoms of andropause, and you know, the number one thing I always have on the slide is fall asleep after dinner, and that woman, you know, elbows and points to the slide, and, you know, like,
tired all the
or
time.
Every single one of those are you.
Yeah. Well, and then again, like, when they, and they'll go through like two or three people by the time they get to Faraday or I in the back, and everything's perfect. And they come back and they're like, they don't have anything wrong. And
there's nothing wrong with them. I'm like, well, they're here. There's something wrong.
Yeah. And it's I agree with you. Like, again, they're more denial, you know, than a woman is, for sure. I mean, I think women can be there too, but they're not in front of us when they're denying. they're in front of us because they want help. And men are still somewhat denying. You got to kind of slowly open that conversation a little more with them. They're not always willing to, even when the partner brings them in. But so then the hormone is one of them. And I love that. You know, again, it's, and I love when they ask us also, you know, if everything, you know, if this will fix everything, whether it's the hormones or the Gaines Wave and P-Shot, which we'll just touch on. You know, I'm like, the only guarantee is really that everything's going to get worse with time, if not addressed, right? Yeah,
that's absolutely. You know how this plays out in the end if they let it go.
And it's harder to treat the 60-year-old house with no maintenance over 60 years, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they didn't know we could do it before. But again, so the urologist and traditional doctors are only offering them prescription Cialis, Viagra, right? Really not offering anything else.
No. We hear so often, well, my doc said my testosterone levels are normal. Well, that scales 264 to 916 if you look at LabCorp. Yeah. I mean, it doesn't fit in that. Just about every man.
What is your response to that usually, George?
Well, my response, first of all, I go, where does it say normal on this lab? It says reference interval.
Yeah.
And like you said, 216 is at 2.5 percentile. And 924, whatever the high number is at 97.5 percentile.
Exactly.
And this is taken from an average of men who are aged 19 to 39. I'm sorry, but most of our men are a little bit older than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it has nothing to do with it. You know, and I just tell them, I don't care what that number says. If you're 60 years old, it's a third of what it was when you were 25.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it falls between 2.5%. What man would drive his car with 2.5% of the oil in the crankcase? No.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's going to.
Because it's going to blow.
But they think that, yeah, well, it's normal. No, it doesn't say normal. It just doesn't say L or low, which happens below 2.5 percentile.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I hate that reference range there because too many.
I just mark it out.
Yeah.
I say ignore that.
Yeah. Ignore it.
But again, that's like the most common thing. Mm-hmm. Like I'm tested and, oh, everything's normal. They're 70.
My doc said I'm normal.
My doc said I'm normal and gave me Viagra, but I'm still having issues. Yeah, because we're not normal.
Mm-hmm. You're not normal.
We need to optimize. No, we got stuff to do.
You might be normal for a 60-year-old man, but you're not normal for how you want to feel because you want to have the erection of a 25 or 30-year-old man. And that's not going to happen with the testosterone level that's in the dirt.
I love it. Mm-hmm. So again, we always say like 80% of it is, you know, a blood flow and 20% is hormones. Obviously, optimizing hormones, none of the other stuff works unless you've optimized hormones. But again, so blood flow, Gaines Wave and P-Shot, if you want to just touch on, just so they know there's a more comprehensive treatment available besides the little blue pill, which is what they think.
Yeah. Well, you know, so testosterone works, you know, not just on the libido level, but is a vasodilator.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, it is increasing blood flow as well as doing a lot of the other stuff, especially the mental aspect of it all. Gaines Wave acoustic wave treatment, I think, is just fantastic. You know, it's non-invasive, men. That means it doesn't hurt. It's a way of delivering a sound wave basically to the penis that I can't tell you the mechanism. But it actually will increase the blood flow. And, and it begins to work oftentimes after the very first treatment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, most guys will need a series of treatments depending on what kind of symptoms that they have. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, maintenance, like, you know, painting a house.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a lot of coats in the beginning, but your house is not going to stay pretty and painted unless you keep it up every, you know, so often. So they do need to do that. I'll let you talk either as little or as much about Gaines as you want to. It's up to you.
Well, I think as long as that, I mean, the primary care doctors, urologists are not talking about it. So I think that a lot of men that are tuning into this or even women that are looking for solutions for their spouse are wanting to hear that there's other options because that's the only thing presented to them. And you really have to approach somebody that specializes in sexual wellness for men, somebody like Dr. Ibrahim in Asheville, you know, RMD here in Knoxville, or somebody trusted, you know, which there's a Gaines Wave directory, there's, you know, P-Shot, O-Shot directory. There's ways to find those providers in a local area, but again, or you can travel to a place that has them.
And I think the combinations are key.
Mm-hmm.
You know, guys that would have to take 100 milligrams of sildenafil, Viagra, undergo Gaines Wave protocol, and now they're able to get by with 50 milligrams and half the headache and half the other side effects because they've helped on a different way. So it's you know, different mechanisms all looking to go to the same goal.
Increase blood flow, better erections. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, so P-shot, just so that we are.
So P-shot, I'll let you do the explanation of that, what that is.
Yeah. So Gaines Wave, again, is basically working on the blood vessels and tissue and telling it it's injured and using acoustic shockwave to, you know, basically say it's injured and get repair, you know, increase blood flow and better erections. And then P-shot works with it. And we always use it in combination. You know, there's some exceptions, but usually we're recommending it in combination. And we're drawing your own blood and getting PRP and then injecting that PRP or growth factors, platelets. Sorry, PRP is platelet-rich plasma. Platelets have growth factors, re-injecting them in to get growth in an area, you know, stimulate repair. So blood vessels, nerves, you know, collagen, elastin, all that. So better erections, better blood flow, again. And they augment each other.
Absolutely. They augment, the end game is regeneration.
Yeah.
And in fact, now whenever we do a P-shot, whether or not they've signed up for a full Gaines Wave protocol, we're always doing a mini Gaines Wave treatment, you know, as we do the P-shot, because we're increasing the blood flow at the same time that we're doing the P-shot.
We talk a lot about that in the office, especially even with like our women that want to do an O-shot. They come in and they're like, I just want an O-shot. And I'm like, well, let's do some radio frequency, something with it. Tell the tissue there's damage. So when we dump all these growth factors in, we're going to get a better result.
Yeah, absolutely. So at least they know that there's other options in addition to prescriptions, you know, because that's, you know, those are the answers they're getting. And sometimes they don't know. Fortunately, there's more information out there and people will hear it on the radio. I don't know if it happens with you, but we don't advertise on the radio, but we get a lot of patients in for Gaines Wave advertising on the radio. Somebody else advertised, they look on the Gaines Wave and they find us and then they come in, but we've never done any advertising on the radio. So, I mean, they hear Gaines Wave and they know how to look at that, but they don't remember.
They know how to Google.
Yeah. So finding a Gaines Wave provider is good. So anything else you think we should add? You know, like otherwise, I think, again, the results of like those more comprehensive treatments are really lowering a dose of something you're already using to try and get erections. And again, if you're not optimized on hormones, then, you know, that's the first step.
I mean,
absolutely.
I think it's, you know, will I write for it? Yeah, only because I know I'm not going to hurt somebody. But I'll tell them, I go, that they're spending their money in the wrong order.
Well, good. Well, then, obviously, if anyone has any comments or questions, anything you want to hear more about, just drop them in the comments underneath. And again, thank you so much for being on and talking to us about the little blue pills. Dr. Ibrahim.
And all the other things too.
So, and again, he has a wealth of knowledge with all of this. And frequently he gets phone calls from me asking specific questions. And it's awesome to have that sounding board.
You guys have got a great practice going, Dr. Durst. I so appreciate all the help you've given me. And I look forward to coming to Knoxville soon.
All right. Awesome. Well, thank you so much.
Thanks for coming on and talking with us. Bye-bye.